Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. It's good to see you out with us again on this lovely warm Sunday morning. It's almost too warm, isn't it? It's really rough. It's nice and cool actually inside, but outside, jeepers, it is warm out there. It's been a good couple of weeks, and sure the farmers are loving that, or maybe the farmers are looking for rain now. You're never happy, farmers, are you? Good to see you out. We're here to worship the Lord, and it's great that we have the ability and the freedom to be able to do that. Just a few announcements before we get started. First of all, Holiday Bible Club is on the 14th to the 18th of August. We'll get, I'm sure, some promotional material for that at some point soon. There is a sign-up sheet in the vestibule for volunteers. Thanks for those who have signed up. There is a meeting this Tuesday, that's the 13th, at 7:30 here in the hall. So just a reminder for anyone there volunteering for Holiday Bible Club, come on Tuesday at 7:30 here in the hall behind me. And if you haven't signed on the sheet, you're still welcome to come along to that meeting. Also, next week is Children's Day. So the children are taking part in Children's Day next week. And I know they've been rehearsing. You'd hear some lovely voices singing their hearts out about half an hour ago. So I'm looking forward to hear that. They're taking part in different aspects of the service. There will be a collection next Sunday for the Sunday school as well. Also, I said a couple of weeks ago, or maybe last week, about volunteers for Youth Club. If you would like to volunteer for the Youth Club, I'm not sure what day it's going to be. Last time it used to be on the Saturday evening, but that's up for negotiation. But if you'd like to be part of the Youth Club, and we can get it back up and running again, do give me your name, please. I also did mention about a pastoral care team. If anyone would like to be part of that, also give me your name, just for those people who maybe weren't here last week. There's different aspects of pastoral care. My role as the minister is for preaching, teaching, discipleship. My role in pastoral visits is very much spiritual, but there's different ways we can show pastoral care, and you guys do this very well because you're very much a family here, and it's great to see that. You do look out for each other when someone is sick or whatever. But to have it a bit more sort of formal, but not too formal as well, there's some people who maybe could do with someone popping in for a cup of tea and a chat, and it doesn't take specific people to do that. Anyone can do that. But if we have a list of people who maybe need someone or who are lonely, and we have a list of people who are happy to go and see that, we can then sort of say to such and such a person, well, listen, would you like to go and see whoever it is and have a cup of tea and a chat with them because they're a bit lonely? So think about that if you want to give me your name for that as well. And then one last announcement before we bring our offering up. There's a sheet that's going to be handed out at the end, actually. Let me read what it says on the sheet. After much discussion and prayer, Mossside and Toberdoney Kirk Sessions have decided to combine their services in July and August. During the summer months, many people go away for holidays or for the day, leaving one or both churches a little lighter in numbers, some perhaps quite light in numbers. By combining the services, there will be a greater number of people together worshipping the Lord, thereby enhancing the worship experience in both churches. And this is especially important when it comes to our children. We plan to hold our services in the church hall with tea and coffee afterwards. This is to accommodate the increased numbers and to keep things similar in both venues. It also allows for a time of fellowship after the service. As Sundays in the summer are often the time when people go away for the day, the service time will be at 10:30 throughout the summer here and when it's in Mossside as well, allowing time for families to attend worship and still head out for the rest of the day if they so desire. We are aware that some people perhaps walk to the church, so if that is the case, please reach out to your elder who will be more than happy to arrange transport for you. As the venue will change from week to week, it'll be 1 week in Mossside, 1 week in Toberdoney, and it'll alternate throughout the summer. When it comes to free will offering, if you're a Mossside member, bring your envelopes to the service held in Mossside. If you're a Toberdoney member, bring your envelopes when the service is held in Toberdoney. When it comes to live streaming, that's going to be a bit difficult because it will be in the hall and we're not set up for live streaming there, but we will record the service and upload it onto the YouTube feed shortly after the service, hopefully that afternoon. Each service will be an all-age service and have a family feel to it. Children will be very much part of the service, and the service will be slightly shorter as a result. fresh facilities will be available. We do acknowledge this as a new venture within our churches, but we hope that you will embrace and enjoy this time of fellowship together with our brothers and sisters in the Lord. That's what it says on the sheet. If you have any questions on that, do come and bring them to me. You'll get a wee copy of that and a list of where we are and what dates on the way out. So thanks for your attention on that. Today we're going to worship the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who set us free from our sin and broke the chains that bound us to it. Let's give thanks to the one who rescued us from slavery and brought us into his kingdom. Our first act of worship is thanksgiving for the offering. So would the stewards please come forward? And we're going to pray for our offering. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the mercies that are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness to us each and every day. You provide for us in so many ways, and we give back to you some of your provision. And we do so as a way to say thank you to you and to recognize that we are totally dependent on you to provide for us. So take these tithes and offerings and bless them, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to sing our opening hymn, And Can It Be?
I'm
We're going to pray together now, a prayer I've adapted from Psalm 145. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we exalt you, our God the King. We will praise your name forever and ever. Every day we will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Your greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And we will meditate on your wonderful works, for they tell the power of your awesome works. And we will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. Lord, you are gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. You are good to all. You have compassion on all you have made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and your glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. You are trustworthy in all your promises and faithful in all you do. You uphold all who fall. You lift up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at their proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. You are righteous in all your ways and faithful in all you do. You are near to all who call on you in truth. You fulfill the desires of those who fear you. You hear their cry and you save them. You watch over all who love you, but all the wicked you will destroy. And so our mouths will speak in praise of you, Lord. Let every creature praise your holy name forever and ever. Amen. Boys and girls, come down to the front and I'll see you down there. Well, how are we doing? Are we good? All ready for next week? Can't wait. I heard some of you singing and it was angelic. It was great. But I can't wait for next week. Now, I need two volunteers and there aren't many volunteers here. So maybe the two sisters. Did you hurt your arm? No? Oh.
Was that a hickey?
Does it work? Does it? Hmm. Right, anyway. Right, you two come up here. And hello you, you're very welcome, the other one's not. Right, stand up for me please. Put your arms together. No, not like that, just beside each other. There we go, right, I'm going to wrap you up here. Hang on a second now. Put it right there. Yeah. You have to stay like this for the next week. How do you go to sleep? Well, hang on a second.
I hurt my cheek on the bouncy castle.
You hurt your cheek on a bouncy castle? Well, you have to tell me about that later on. Right, hang on a second. Give me your arms. Let me tie this up. Oh, wait, it's spark. Right.
And it was like red.
Right, now. Is that too tight? I don't want your hands falling off. Right, now. How does that feel? Do you think you'd be able to go through the day like that?
No.
What would happen? Like, I tell you what happens if you want to go over there, Eliza, and you want to go over there, Tilly?
So, come back. So, is Eliza perhaps a little bit stronger than you, Tilly? So if you wanted to go over there, you can't, because Eliza's just, she's telling you what to do, isn't she? She's dictating what you do. And let's say... Uh-oh. Now, here, so if you want to go that way, you're okay with that, but you can't. Or if you want to, let's say you want to, I don't know, when you're going to school, what are you going to do? You'd have to go to her class, wouldn't you? She'd come to your class. So, do you think, hang on a second, let's concentrate here for a wee second. So, do you think that it would be fun and to stay like that for the rest of the day, the rest of the week? No, not at all. Eliza, would you like that if you were bound to her for the rest of the week? No? What do you think, Noah? You don't think that would be fun? What do we need to do to break that bond, that rope on our string on our
scissors?
Now, completely derailed here. Right, so we need scissors. I'm not going to cut it just yet, okay? Because boys and girls, this is like sin. We talk about sin all the time, but there's a reason why. You can sit down. Well, sit down for a second. And so you had to sit down. There's something, we talk about sin being the bad stuff that we do, don't we? Yeah? Isn't that right, Eliza? What are you doing? We talk about sin being the bad stuff you do, don't we? Yeah? Yeah? There's more than that, though. Sin is also something inside us that forces us to do things that we don't want to do. Like those two being bound together. I'm going to cut you in a wee second. Wait a second. Not cut you, cut the rope. Like, you don't have a choice, Tilly. You have to do what Eliza wants you to do. Like, she's moving your arm over there. You don't have a choice. Right, so what we need to do is let's cut this here. What we need is we need to be set free from our sin. Like that. Like we sang in the song, our chains are gone. Does that feel better? You feel free, don't you? Now, Tilly, come to me. How do we get free from our sin? No, we don't cut it. That's how you get free from a bit of rope. How do you get free from sin?
What?
How do you get free from sin? How do you get free from sin? This only represents sin, our sin. Sin in our lives. How do we get free from sin? Pray to who?
God.
Yeah, and ask him to forgive us. When we ask Jesus to forgive us from our sin, he breaks that chain of sin on us that forces us to do things that we don't want to do. And, give me your arm. Wrap this round my arm. Right, here's one here. Wrap this round. There, a few times. You don't have to tie it. Just there we go. Right. And we are now bound to Jesus Christ. And Jesus helps us to do the things that are good, that are right, that God wants us to do. Doesn't mean we stop sinning, but it's like we have a wee voice in our head, a wee feeling in our head, the Holy Spirit that tells us, you know what? This is the right thing to do. This is the thing you're supposed to do. This is the thing that would please me. So when we give our life to Jesus, he breaks the bond from our sin, but he binds us to Jesus, and Jesus helps us to live our life the right way. But not only that, he also becomes our Father, not just a master. He becomes our Father, and he's a good Father, and we will talk about what a good Father is next week in Children's Day. So I want you to remember that. Sin binds us to itself to make us do things that goes against God. But when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, he will cut the binds of sin, and we're bound to him, and we will do what he wants us to do. You remember that, boys and girls? We're going to sing a new song now. It's a song called Jesus Strong and Kind. It's a very easy song to sing. Do you want to play it through once and then we'll sing it? Thank you. Back to the start, thank you. Let's come before the Lord together again in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and we worship you, for you are God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, creator of all humankind, and our Lord and Savior. We praise you, for you are truth. Your word is truth. Your spirit is truth. And we are to worship you in spirit and in truth. But we live in a world of lies, where people deceive each other and twist the truth to suit their own ends. And we confess that we often get caught up in that too. Forgive us, we pray, for our own lies and deception. Forgive us for taking the truth and twisting it for our own end. Forgive us for being like the world. Help us to be aware of our own lies. May we be aware of the lies we tell ourselves. May we be aware of the lies we tell others. May we be aware of a life that is a lie unto you. Once again, forgive us and help us to walk in the truth. Bring us this morning to a real awareness of ourselves and move in us, we pray. Convict us of where we need you to come and bring your truth. Father, we are here waiting for you to speak to us, to show us your ways. Maybe follow those ways. Give us the courage to follow you and make whatever changes we need to make in our lives so that we can grow deeper and deeper in love with you. And give us the courage to be your disciples, to be your ambassadors in the world in which we live. Give us the strength and the willingness to reach out to a hurting world and tell them the good news that Jesus Christ can set them free. In whose name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing again, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
We come now to the word of the Lord, as found in John chapter 8, and we're going to read from verses 31 to 46. This is the word of the Lord, and it says, "To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, 'If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.' They answered him, 'We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?' Jesus replied, 'Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, yet you're looking for a way to kill me, because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you are doing what you have heard from your father. Abraham is our father,' they answered. If you were Abraham's children,' said Jesus, 'then you would do what Abraham did. As it is, you're looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You're doing the works of your own father.' 'We are not illegitimate children,' they protested. 'The only father we have is God himself.' Jesus said to them, 'If God were your father, you would love me, for I have come here from God. I have not come on my own. God sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Yet because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? If I am telling the truth, why don't you believe me?" We end there at verse 46. Let's pray as we come to the word of the Lord. Father, we're asking you to set us free from so many things today. Of course, yes, set us free from sin, but set us free from apathy. Set us free from distraction. Help us to focus on the truth that is your word. Remove the distraction, we pray. Unhinge us. Break those binds that bind us to the things that are going to get in the way of hearing your word. Set us free from those things, we pray, in the power of your Spirit. And may we focus on you. And may you open our hearts and minds to be receptive to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to start today with a question. And the question is this: do you have free will? Are you free to make your own choice about anything you want? Do you have freedom to choose whatever you want to do? When you got up this morning, did you choose what you ate? Maybe you didn't have a choice. When you go shopping, are you free to choose to buy whatever you want to buy? Do you have free will? I want you to look at this ad on the screen. What do you think about this ad? What does this ad say to you? It's supposed to give the impression that if you go to this gym, you will perform better. Perform better at what? I'm not so sure. Look better and be better. Again, be better at what? The woman looks like she's in pain. This is practically the only gym ad I could show in a church service. Other ads are a little more revealing, and they tend to choose a certain type of person with certain type of assets that you couldn't show in a church service. Now, when you see this ad, does it make you want to go to the gym? For some people it might, for other people it might not. But somewhere in our subconscious, it makes us believe that we can be better if we just get to the gym and exercise. For me, it's not enough to make me go to the gym. I'm not driven by a thirst to be fitter, I'm driven by a thirst to be fatter. If I'm honest, my desire for food drives me as well, you know. So if I saw that gym ad, I'd be like, eh. But if I saw this ad, it would be a different story. Just the sight of that ad would get me into the shop. In fact, when looking for an ad for kebabs, specifically Sphinx kebabs, because they're the best, I saw pictures of other people's kebab, not an ad, just people's dinner that they took a photo of. And I almost got in my car and drove to Belfast to get one. That ad, seeing that whole package, sends me to another place. My senses are piqued. I get weak at the knees just looking at that ad in front of me now. It's all I can think about. Kate needn't worry about me lusting after that woman in the gym ad, but I'm certainly lusting after that kebab. See, with me, it's food. For others, it's the gym. The gym ad might work. For someone else, it might be a tractor. I saw a new ad for tires. Have you seen it in Ballymoney, beside the office supplies there? Ascenso tires, available at Finvoy Tires, by the way. Maybe that makes farmers go weak at the knees, I don't know. For others, it might be clothes, electronics, gadgets, TVs, the list goes on. Apparently, we see 10,000 ads a day. 10,000 ads a day, and we don't realize it. Even supermarkets are laid out in such a way to make you spend more money and buy more stuff. Brands, companies pay the store to have their products at eye level so that you see them easier. Stuff that appeals to children, lower down at their eye level so that they can pester the parents to buy the stuff, which inevitably you do just to keep them quiet. And so the placement of certain items are on purpose. For example, the bread, where is it? If you think of the few shops I know, it's at the back corner. Bread's one of your staples. Put it at the back corner so they have to walk past all the other things to get to the bread and hopefully buy stuff as they go along. Now, we don't really think about this, do we? But we're being influenced in many ways every single day. Marketing is controlling our decisions. So back to my first question, do we really have free will? Because if we think about it, our decisions are very much influenced by the advertising around us, to the point where there's some element of persuasion that's gone into the decisions we make, and we may not even realize it. And so in a big way, we are slaves to our impulses and our urges. Let's take it further. Thinking about urges, we are dictated to by our body. For example, when you gotta go, you gotta go. You can kind of hold it in for a short while, but ultimately there's no fighting. Think about sleep. We're bound to the urge to sleep. We have to sleep. We can't avoid it. So much so that every 24-hour period is arranged around our sleep. We can't avoid that. So for some things, we actually don't have a choice. We don't have a choice not to sleep. Because if we don't sleep or we don't eat, we're going to die. And while we might think we're free, in many ways, we aren't. We're a slave to our urges. We're a slave to our impulses. We are a slave to advertising. Let's take it further. In our passage today, Jesus has been speaking to some people, and these are people who believe. He's had this whole talk with different people. Some people are out to get him, but there are some people who believe. But their belief isn't fully developed. It's not very strong. We see that a few verses later, because their reaction to Jesus is not the reaction of someone who's following Christ. But he's speaking to people who have believed him so far. They believe what he says. They maybe believe in who he is, but they haven't fully committed to following Jesus. They haven't entered into this. As one guy said, they have ideas about Christ, but not an experience of the preciousness of Christ. And Jesus tells them this: if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. And the word hold to is better translated as remain in, stay in, abide in. In other words, you guys kind of believe, but you haven't really entered into the essence of knowing me and having a relationship with me. And so he's saying, hold on to my words, stay in them, remain in them, meditate on them, make my words your dwelling place, make it your bread and butter, make my teaching your life. And if you do that, then you will truly be my disciples. In fact, that's how I know you're a disciple of mine. Now, let's pause there for a second. We've talked about following Jesus and following what he teaches. John's made sure to point this out many times. We have to follow what Jesus teaches. But what we have here and what Jesus says is the marks of a true disciple. A true disciple is someone who abides in the words of Jesus Christ, who lives in, dwells in Jesus' teaching. And this separates those who believe stuff about Jesus and those who are fully participating in Jesus and are his disciples. I'm sure there are many people in the world who would say that following what the Bible says is very restrictive. I would like to decide what I do and what I don't do. It's my life. It's my choice. As someone said to me once, you can't put a gun to my head and tell me what to do. But the truth is, nobody's putting a gun to anyone's head. But we have people who believe stuff about Jesus, and we have people who are fully committed to Jesus and what Jesus is saying. And so what we do, this is what Jesus is saying to these people, what we do with God's word is the difference between believing things about Jesus and actually fully participating in being his disciples. That's how you spot the difference between the two. If we follow God's word, it shows that we're a true disciple, Jesus says. If we ignore it and do our own thing, it shows that we're not. We might believe in stuff about Jesus, sure, but we're not fully entering into following him. But again, I get it. We would like to be free to make our own choices rather than having someone tell us what we can and can't do. And that's the feeling that most people have about what we believe. I won't have some dusty, outdated book telling me what I can and can't do and telling me what's right and what's wrong. I want to make those choices myself. You can't tell me what to do. I can't have some old, outdated book telling me what to do. It's my life. It's my choice. And I get it that some people might not want to be a slave to what Jesus says or what the Bible says. But even if you want to make these decisions yourself, are you completely free? Back to the advertising. Are we really free to make our own choices? You see, a few verses later, Jesus says, actually, we are not free at all. He says, if you sin, you're a slave to sin. Now he's getting to the core of what these believers really think. See, these guys think from verse 33 that because they are descendants of Abraham, that they're chosen people, and that anyone who is a descendant of Abraham is saved from hell just because they're a descendant from Abraham. I was born in this line. I can trace my family ancestry right back to Abraham. I am saved from hell. I'm going to heaven. I'm in the kingdom of God. That's me sorted. But the truth is, they still need to repent and trust in Jesus. But because they're Abraham's descendants, they didn't think they needed to do that. So they didn't consider that they're actually a slave to sin, as Jesus said. They need to break free from that. It's not much different from people today who think that because they go to church, or because they've been baptized, somehow they're saved. Or if you've taken your first communion, that's you in the door. You're going to heaven when you die. And you can even stop coming to church. You can stop abiding in the word of God because you've been baptized, you're taking your communion, you're okay. How many people have you seen have taken their first communion and you never see them again? If you know someone who thinks like this, please, please, in love and in gentleness, let them know that being baptized or taking your first communion doesn't guarantee you anything. Back to the passage, though. These believers didn't realize that they were enslaved to sin, which, by the way, is everyone before they come to Christ. They think that because they're descendants of Abraham, they have some right to the kingdom of God. And Jesus says, no. You're a slave, and as such, you have no rights. In fact, sin is directing what you do. You think you're free, but you're not. You're being directed by sin. Sin is making the choices for you. So Jesus is saying, you think you're in the kingdom because you're Abraham's descendants. Think again. Or to make it more relevant today, you think you're in the kingdom because you've been baptized, or because you've taken your communion, or because you go to church. Think again. If that is the case, though, what do we do? How do I know if I'm a believer or if I'm fully participating in what Jesus is teaching? First of all, it's important to note that sin isn't just doing bad stuff. That's kind of the simple definition of it, but it's more than that. It is doing bad stuff and doing stuff against the word of God, but it's more than that. Sin is something within us. It is that subconscious advertising that drives us to go against God's desire for us. It's a driving force behind the decisions that we make. Paul says in Romans 8 that sinful minds are actually hostile to God. And they don't submit to his law. In fact, he says they can't submit to his law. So it's not just that we do some bad stuff. There's something within us that is hostile to God. And it directs our decisions and our choices. It directs us to sin. It directs us to do stuff that goes against what God says. So whether we like it or not, we are slave to sin. We are enslaved to it. So while we think we have the choice to do whatever we want, or the freedom to do whatever we want, in fact, we don't have a choice at all. We will always do what sin directs us to do. And that's anything that goes against the word of God. And unless someone sets us free, that's the way it's always going to be. Just look at the world. They think they're free. They think they can choose to do whatever they want to do. But if you boil it down, they don't have a choice at all. They're doing stuff that goes against what God wants. Sex, for example, with whomever, whenever, outside of the covenant of marriage. I have that choice. Greed. Let's amass as much wealth as I can so I can be happy and do whatever I want. I have that choice. Pride. I'm the master of my own destiny and I have the choice as to what that destiny is. Lust. If I want it, then I'm going to have it. If I want that other person's wife, I'm going to try and take her. If I want that person's job, I'm going to undermine them so that I can get their position. It's my choice, my life, my decision. Actually, that's sin directing all those choices to go against what God wants. So the world thinks that they have a choice, but they don't. They're doing everything that sin wants them to do. Because sin is directing their choice, every decision they make. So what do? Well, we listen to Jesus. He says, if you hold to my teaching, you're really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. These people believed in stuff about Jesus, but they didn't fully participate in following him and embracing the amazing relationship he offered them. They thought they were saved because they were descendants of Abraham, and they kind of agreed with Jesus in principle, but they hadn't fully entered into a saving faith in him. And so Jesus says, excuse me, if you want to be set free, like if you want to be properly set free, free from your slavery, then enter into this full, deep relationship with me. Hang on to my every word. Sit in my words. Walk around in them. Make my teaching your bread and butter. Make it your life. Properly follow me. Follow what I'm teaching. And your eyes will be open to the truth, and the truth will set you free. Because as we find out in chapter 14, Jesus is the truth. And God's word points us to Jesus. The only one who can set us free from our slavery to sin. And he did it through his death and resurrection. And this freedom is for anyone who fully enters into following Jesus. Not just running through the religious motions, but who has a saving relationship with him through faith. Bottom line, thinking that we have a choice in life and that we're free is a lie. It is a lie. Truth is, we're never free. Because we were created so that God could be our perfect master. And then sin became our master. But it's one or the other. I saw this just at the weekend. Someone gave this illustration. Imagine you get a fish. You have a fish bowl and there's a fish in the bowl. And you take the fish out of the bowl and you put it on the ground and say, you're free. You're no longer bound by the water and in this bowl. You're no longer bound by that. You're free. Go live your life. What's going to happen to the fish? It's going to die. Because the fish was created to be within that bowl of, or to be within water anyway. Not necessarily a bowl, but in water. And if you take the fish out of water and say you're free, it's not free. We were created to be under the control of God, with God as our master. That is where we are alive. Take us out of that and we die. So the question becomes, would we rather be chained to sin or chained to Jesus? Chained to death or chained to life? And then we need to ask ourselves a question, do we think we're saved because we believe in stuff about Jesus and because we go to church and so on? Or are we saved and set free from sin because we totally, fully embrace everything that Jesus teaches us and embrace him as our Lord and Savior? But for anyone who has been set free from their slavery, what does it mean for us now? Well, like I said, when we've been set free from our slavery to sin, we come under the care of our rightful master, Jesus Christ. Back to the way things were supposed to be from the beginning. We're back to the way we were supposed to be, that sort of bowl of water. We're in our home place. Paul talks about being a slave to righteousness in Romans 6. He says these things. He said, when you were slaves to sin, so he agrees with Jesus, of course. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things that you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness. The result, eternal life. So he essentially says here, listen, when you were slaves to sin, yeah, you thought you were free, but you weren't. You were slaves to sin. I mean, sure, you were free from following what God wants you to do, but where did that get you? Shame, he says. Dissatisfaction, there's no life in you. In fact, you were dead. Yeah, but I was free to make my own choices. Yeah, no, you weren't. You were chained to death. Sin was directing your choices, Paul says. But now you've been set free from that slavery to sin. You're now under the care of a good master, a better master, a kind master, a master who wants the best for you, God himself. And this leads to holiness and life. Doesn't mean we stop sinning. It leads to holiness. That's why we go to church. That's why we read our Bible. That's why we do the things the Bible says, because we are now submitting to our new master. But if we're to read on, not only is God our master, he is our father, because in Romans 8 it says, the Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. So he's not just our master, he's our father. If we are children, then we're heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. This is great news. Through our faith in Jesus Christ, through fully entering into this relationship with him, not just believing about him, but following him as his disciples, we get set free from the chains of sin and death, and we're brought into God's family where there's life. But now that the truth has set us free, we need to remember that our lives are not our own. We are bought with a price, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6. But remember, we were never free in the first place. If you think you're free, if anyone thinks they're free when they're not trusting in Christ, they're not free. Yeah, you might be free from doing what the Bible says, but you're not free because you're slaves to sin. You're doing what sin says. We are truly free when we come to Christ because we are where we're supposed to be. Our natural desire is to live for ourselves and do what we want to do. And Jesus has reminded us that actually we were never doing what we wanted to do. We were always doing what sin wanted us to do. But now that we're free, let's not use this freedom to do what we want to do. Let's remember that Jesus is now our master. So let's humble ourselves and say, Lord, I'm yours now. I'm your child. So what is it that you want me to do? How do you want me to live my life as your child, as a child of God set free from sin? Show me what that is. That's done by abiding in the word of God. Make it your bread and butter. Because that is the mark of a true disciple of Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for opening our eyes to the fact that nobody is ever free. So many people out in the world think they're free to do whatever they want to do, but they're not. They're slaves. They're slaves to sin, and yet their eyes are blind to the fact. They think they're free, but they are so not. But Lord, we thank you that Jesus Christ has the power to set us free from our sin, to break those chains that bind us to sin and to give us that freedom, but real, true freedom under your direction, because we're now slaves to you. We're now bound to a good master, a master who wants the best for us, a master who has now become our father, and we thank you for that. Help us to live our lives as your children. Help us to ask that question, how do you want us to live our lives? Help us to abide in your word, to hold on to your word, to make your word our bread and butter, so that we can be true disciples of Jesus. In whose name we pray. Amen. Our whole theme with respect to the hymns has been about being set free from chains and sin. Let's close our service by singing Living Hope. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.